Welcome back to Let's Interactively Play Steve Jackson's Sorcery. I am the RPG Chick, and as always, this is a Let's Play, which you choose at the end what decision we are to make going forward into the next episode. So, don't forget to leave your votes down below when we get to the end of the episode. Bloop. So, it was unanimous once again. It's been unanimous for several weeks now. Right, we're continuing along a curving street. Right, we're all the way on the east side now, sort of kind of getting to the end of this chapter 3, but we still do have 4 serpents to fight. I know where one of them is, and I think another one's supposed to be around here as well, at least. So, yeah, we found this abandoned, like, ruined village. You continue along a curving street until you pass a large doorway in the surprisingly intact ruins of a hall. Lying in the doorway is what looks like a massive, oversized finger. A dead giant, perhaps? Oh! Someone, I'm sorry. Was it you, Jack? I think you were talking about giant teeth? It says a dead giant, perhaps. I missed that. If so, or I forgot that, if so, you might be able to acquire a few more precious teeth to add to your collection. You follow the line of the finger inside the building along the length of an arm that disappears under a pile of rubble and stones. Now it's unanimous that we should unbury the arm. So I don't remember who said that. In any case, my apologies. Unbury the arm. You go over to the rubble and begin to haul it away. Once you have cleared a few rocks, you begin to see the first wisps of thick hair from the giant's beard underneath the stone. If he is in fact dead, he cannot have died too long ago. Well, we're not going to leave it now. That'd be silly. Let's keep working. Watching my stamina to see if it lowers with effort here. You keep working, removing stones with an aim to reaching the giant's lower jaw. Poor the guys, these guys are like looking for their teeth all the time. You know, they're like some giant's teeth are a commodity in this land. But after removing a flat slab of stone from across his mouth, he was struck by a hot, wet blast of breath. The giant is not dead at all. He is sleeping. If he is in fact dead. Well, I don't know. I kind of feel these things are usually, violent. At the very least, ornery. But I don't think I should try to kill it in its sleep. Just out of curiosity, what spells could I theoretically cast? Yeah, I'd feel bad doing that. This is the... Wait. Float in the air, yeah. Above a sleeping giant. And what? Just, like, pull his tooth out? I don't know what aim that would be. Turn to stone. Well, I have stone dust. Would a giant's tooth even work? Turn to stone. Yeah, I feel bad doing this stuff. Sharpen blade. Well, can't do that. Beeswax. We can turn into giant form. Or create a shield. Or create an invisible wall. Yeah, I'm sorry, guys. I really... If this thing is awake and threatening me, I have no qualms attacking it, but not when he's asleep. But he's asleep with... covered with stone. Was he knocked unconscious by the stone? Or was he just too lazy to get up? I'm gonna creep away in any case. There's an old adage that one should let sleeping giants lie, so you quickly move away. Your loop of the upper city is finished. The sun begins to dip, heading towards the horizon. I don't know if there's a good place to... Alright, I do want to head to the tower, but what about the low city? I haven't been here, right? At least I don't think so. You walk through the ruins of the building that spread across the floor of the valley. One seems to be a large warehouse, though whatever was stored here has been taken by the winds long ago. Keep exploring. You pick your way over a low wall and through the shattered outline of a family home. A vague depression in one corner indicates an old fire pit. Look in the fire pit. You scratch in the dirt of the fire pit for a time, but find nothing beyond a few shards of broken pottery. You leave the old house by what was once the doorway. Scratched on the doorstep is a chiseled mark, perhaps a drawing of some kind. Let's look at the marks. You squat to examine the marks. They were perhaps once more detailed, and are almost worn away by the scouring dust. A cat, large and striped, is curled up into a ring for warmth. Wait, is that a mark of a cat curled up into a ring for warmth? Or an actual cat? I'm guessing it's a mark, a picture of a cat. I don't know what I'm casting a spell for. But as always, I like to... Oh, this is, sense danger. It might be a good idea. Although there's nothing else to do here, we could create a fireball. The cat wants warmth, but yeah, I don't feel like sacrificing 3 out of 8 stamina just on a whim like that. D... what? That's not a spell in our book. Is that it? F? We have this... far. See the future. Find safe passage. You know, sometimes I wonder what the whispering voices mean. Does it mean I'm getting close to something, or is it does that with everything? One stamina. I think it does that whenever we choose a third one. And how is what? Again, same. I don't know. Move on. You loop through another house but find nothing. These streets have been reduced to mere marks in the dust. There are no signs left to tell you what happened here, and nothing more to be discovered. The sun is sinking. Soon it will be dark. Oh well. Let's go to the tower then. Disappointed there's nothing to find here, really. You follow the line of a broken street until you reach the base of the tower. Somehow, amidst all the level buildings, its walls stand firm. Yes, it is magical in construction. The door opens easily. And inside... The inside of the tower is very much like the others you have seen, except that perhaps it was once decorated. The walls are hung with rotten strings, and are set with empty candle brackets. You could go up the tower or back out into the street. Well, obviously. Oh, there's something I'm really actually just realized. I am really looking forward to casting our beam at the village here and going back in time when the village was still standing. We might find some very useful things at that point. The tower also has a brass cylinder set into its center with a glowing crystal at its heart. From here, the plan of the old city is quite clear. winding streets and blocks leaning towards and then up the cliff face, though it has all been scrubbed clear, the stain of human habitation still remains. Look at the view. Looking out across the city, it seems you can see two time periods at once, one fitting on top of the other, but it's impossible to tell which is true and which is the mask. Well, they're both true. It's just different times, right? You watch a child running down a street, only to turn it into the corner and disappear. You watch a dog spring into existence mid-leap. A building throws yellow smoke into the air, but when the smoke clears, the building is ruined and broken. So we're seeing these things without setting the beam on it? It's unusual. Keep watching, I guess. You cannot tear your eyes away. Every time the streets clear or a building falls, you feel your anger toward the Archmage rising. The desolation here is complete. The people you see are both still living and already long destroyed. All right, let's activate the beacon. It sweeps into life. All right, so we're here looking down on that. All right, that's what I want to be doing. Let's see if there's anything changing here. No, mountain's going to block the way. I can also fasten it. Aim it there. There are some... looks like some, maybe a little fishing village on the water there. Cool. Alright, but let's check out the village here. Kind of want to get all of it, you know? If I aim here, well, these look ruined, right? Yeah, let's focus on this lower village, the upper village, actually. The lower is there, so... I don't know if you really need to be this precise, but... You adjust the cylinder. Now almost accustomed... Ooh! Full stamina. Yay! Now almost accustomed to the curious effect of the magical light, it seems to bring the dust of this dead land to life, like a sunbeam picking out motes in the darkness. You feel better for having touched the cylinder. Mm-hmm. You touch the blue crystal and start to move upwards, just so they can look. Yeah. The time serpent was down there. Unless it's moved. Or unless they were wrong and the goblins or dwarves, whoever it was, running. Or running from something else. I really moved this here to try to aim it away, because I don't know what's making this. It looks like it's coming from this tower, but the tower is aimed that way. So I'm not sure what's... Maybe if... I don't know. I tried moving it, but we'll try back over there at some point. That's if I don't find the other four serpents where I am, so... You drop from the sky. You find yourself on top of a tower that looks out over a ruined city. The brass cylinder sits on its bearing track. I adjusted it, right? Okay. You adjust the beam around its track, sweeping light over the land below. So let's climb down. You return down the tower steps. Away from the tower. You head off into the city once more. Night falls. You should try to find somewhere safe to sleep, especially after so long walking with an empty belly. The streets are quiet. Thin candlelight flickers from the windows of the houses. Now it should say we're surprised that... I guess we're not surprised, but... It should say something. Sleep in an alley? I'm not sure how safe this place is, but I guess we have to. We need food. Hopefully we can buy food here somewhere. on these candle-lit homes. You find a quiet alley between two stone buildings to settle down in. You should be reasonably protected from the elements here. Laying your pack down on the flagstones, you try to settle, despite the cold. You have not yet eaten today, but there is nothing you can do to nourish yourself. Close my eyes. You lie back and try to forget your troubles. You dream you are trapped in a low straw hut, its door sealed with bolts made of bones. A small fire is burning in one corner, but quickly spreads until you are surrounded by flame. You feel yourself starting to sweat from the heat. Wake up. And you wake up to find a ball of fire raging mere inches from you. Hmm. I don't think touching it would be wise. Look at it. Oh, hello there. Firefox. Oh, we're going to fight a web browser. Sweet. The fire does not seem to be fueled. It is a ball about 3 feet wide, gushing with smoke and steam. A moment later, it unravels, uncurling into a long animal form. It is a firefox, and is coming for your neck in a blaze of fur and fire. That's it, guys. I'm moving to Chrome now, so... Do I have a water-based spell? This is bound to be useless. Casting. Oh, that's a force field. Oops. This is darkness. Summon the darkness. Create a stench. We don't have nose plugs. That's a shield. Eh. I've never used that spell. Rock. Turn to stone. I might try that. Sharpened blade. Cannot do. Didn't I have another R-O or something? Or R-A? No. Walk. What was walk? Yeah, shield. Do I use up the stone? Yeah, I don't know. I mean, I do have 17 stamina right now. Pretty good. But we just did get there. Hopefully this doesn't use up the dust. Would make sense if it did, but I gotta try it. Turn to stone. See if we can turn fire into earth. Oh. Obviously it didn't work very well. Reaching up to the constellations overhead, you create the spell, tossing out a handful of stone dust at the firefox, but the creature balls up into flame once more, and the stone dust burns to sparks in a moment and is gone. Then it is upon you. You draw your sword, ready to fight. Alright. 9 stamina. Should I start out bold? Try a higher cut. Good. Cool. 1/3 down. The firefox paces the earth before you, sparks of fire flashing across its fur. Driven by fear, you charge headlong. It snaps at you, but your blow lands in a spurt of blood and fur. The firefox's eyes flash a deep and hot red. Should I press my luck? Good. Well, this is going well. The firefox charges toward you with its jaws open, rolling itself up in flames and fire. What's the difference between flames and fire? You put all your might into a sweep of your blade, hoping to finish the creature in a stroke. The blow connects. As the firefox grows weaker, its eyes grow redder, but its fur begins to turn ash gray. Yeah. It's bound to use some of its plugins against me, so I'm going to defend. so how much with the... Wow, still took 3 off me. With the defend, 3 off me. Damn. The Firefox lashes out with its claws, but you react fast, dropping back. You are badly burned. The monster crouches down and snarls. Cut! Only one down. See, that's not fair. I only took 1 off when it defended. You bring your sword about for a wild blow. The blow catches the Firefox as it dodges back. It scratches at its fur. Oh, I'm gonna risk a side swipe. Good. You turn your blade around for a vicious attack, but your sword cannot reach the Firefox before it leaps. The beast is crawling, dragging its wounded belly through the mud below. Fire flickers across its back. The creature's fur bristles with flame. Oh, I kind of feel sad defeating it. I'm hoping it's weak enough that I can just sideswipe it now. Nope! Ah, not really. Oh, damn! 4 points off. Then the beast is pounding forward, spittle flying from its open jaws. You flick out your blade, but the Firefox is on fire, barreling forward, and you are knocked flying. You howl with pain, batting at fires on the sleeves of your tunic. Stop, drop, and roll, guy! The creature weaves and whines, snapping its jaws. I'm gonna defend this time? Oh, I should've... Oh, damn! Are you freaking up? Eh, I'm gonna redo. It's... I don't know. I know it's... this thing has got me down by 10 points. The Firefox gnashes at the air between you. You fling your sword up and knock it away. You feel yourself weakening. Yeah, not really. You twist your grip about for a manic blow, and the strike catches the beast deep. The Firefox collapses, and in a moment later ignites with a powerful flare. A pyre burns for a short instant, and when it fades, the creature is tight skin around bones with no flesh left. Poor thing. 10 stamina lost. Shameful. I guess it really is from the elemental plane of fire. I'm going to try again. Now the thing is with this game, normally I would not try again. I would roleplay it, like for real, you know? But I think the way this game is, I think you're kind of supposed to try again. I mean, I don't know the way the books are. But I think you're supposed to try for, you know, close to that optimal, you know, attack. Oh, I took 4 off. It rushes you, balling up and igniting as it flies through the air, only to skewer itself on your blade. It twists and writhes. It limps back, bleeding heavily. Dark blue flames gutter between clumps of ragged fur. The monster crouches down and snarls. Well, I could defend here and save some power, get some power back. Or I could cut. I think it's crouching down. I'm not going to do a lot against it. I'm only going to do 1, right? It seems to be in a posture. Yeah, I'm going to defend. Oh, crap. Seriously? The Firefox circles you, hissing and spinning. You hold back, waiting, eyes not leaving the beast. The Firefox's eyes flash a deep and hot red. I'm gonna do a high-level cut. Good. Oh, wow. The Firefox crouches low, then all at once springs up. You stumble back and lose your stance, only to roll aside before the creature lands. You bring your sword up underneath it, catching a gap in its armor. It has armor? The Firefox spits and howls. Yep, this is the same thing that I'm gonna do cut. Good. Much better. No stamina loss. See, now we're like in a much better state here. You bring your sword about for a wild blow, and the strike catches the beast deep. The Firefox collapses, and then a moment later ignites with a powerful flare. A pyre burns for a short instant, and when it fades, yeah, the creature's tight skin around bones with no flesh left. No stamina lost. Flawless fighting. You collapse back, exhausted and scorched from the encounter. With luck, the rest of the night will be more peaceful. Search the creature. Yeah, I hope we find something useful. The creature has no possessions, of course, but has a fine array of teeth, including 4 front fangs that seem to glow with a faint heat. I'm going to take them. With the tip of your sword, you dig out the first of the creature's fangs, but as you tug it free, the tooth cracks and suddenly erupts into flame. You chop it smartly, and the fire burns a moment longer before going out. Let's try with the others, I guess. Working more carefully this time, you manage to extract 2 more fangs without incident. The third is harder work, but you cut and tug carefully and manage to extract it successfully. We are Firefox Dentist. You wrap the teeth in cloth and put them into your pack. These will come in useful should you need to light a fire. For food! For the meat we have! Then tiredness overwhelms you. Time to rest. For the food we have. We bought that food off the cart like 2 episodes ago. Day 20. Sleeping rough. During the past day, you gained considerable stamina, plus 11. Explore the city of Tinpang. Oh, that's what that is, right? And found no new clues. And heard very loud music. Tinpang. You pick yourself to your feet as the sounds of the city begin to gather pace around you. The night has been cold and rough, and you are glad to be moving once more. When can I burn my food and make, actual food that I can eat? Rations, right? The streets are alive with activity. People roam the streets, calling to one another and talking. Musicians stand on street corners, playing lively jigs to passers-by. A nearby building pumps yellow tinged, smoke into the air. I don't know why I couldn't get that. You make your way along the busy, bustling streets, marveling at all the people. Well, they're not really ghosts. They're alive. It's just we're in the past. I mean, everyone's alive when they're not dead, right? Whatever that, I don't know. It's a thriving hub. And out here in the depths of the backlands, knowledge of such a city has been long lost. It has never been mentioned in Annaland. Let's get a drink. We'll look and see what we got. Tower, smoking building, high city. Well, let's head for the smoking building, since that's more specific, right? You approach the smoking building. From inside, there comes a cacophony of sound, crashing and booming, as though a rock demon was inside, fighting against its chains. Is this the giant? Before it got covered with a rock and was sleeping? I don't know how long giants live in this setting. I'm guessing if it lives hundreds of years, it could be. Keep listening. You continue to listen, making out the sound of hammering and grinding above the echoes. This building must extend backwards into the mountainside and be an enormous cavern of activity. Perhaps it is a mine. You turn about as a small boy grabs your arm. Are you supposed to be inside? He asks. Am I supposed to be inside? Hammering and grinding. A mine. Yes? You lie. I thought so, he answers. You're the overseer from Manpeng. You can always tell a sorcerer. Their eyes are rotten. Follow me. Oh, thanks, kid. The boy talks well above his age and acts that way as well. He throws open the door and beckons to you. Let's follow him inside, right? We'll check this place out. You step inside the hot, smoky interior. The factory. So it's a factory. The inside of the factory is filled with a smoky yellow haze. It's like I was drinking. About 100 people are working away at workbenches. The sound of hammer strikes echo around the chamber. What are they all doing? You ask. The boy frowns at you. How do you suppose the powder was extracted from the stone? He replies. Each rock must be crushed, and the spore is extracted. Then it is processed. And he indicates a large contraption in the far corner. It is from here the yellow smoke is belching. You look away for a moment, and when you look back, the boy has vanished. Yeah, I figured he wouldn't stick around, so I figured I'd ask him a question while he was there. Now we can look at a bench. And contraption and stuff. You look over one of the benches. It is piled high with chunks of stone. A few of the workers sort them by some criteria you cannot guess. Those they select are slid across the bench to a hammerer. The rejected rocks seem to simply disappear. Watch the... Yeah. They disappear? I'm kind of curious about that. Watch the disappearing rocks? In fact, it is not the rock which disappears, but the worker doing the sorting as well. They seem to flicker, reappearing a heartbeat later with empty arms or fresh stone. What? One of the adults tries to ease you aside. The boy rushes over to scold him, and he mumbles an apology. Why is the boy yelling at the adult? Trying to ease me aside? Meaning what? Move me out of the way or make me leave the place? Oh, what do you mean, ease me aside? Let's look at this contraption before I talk to people. You head over to the contraption and watch as a line of children feed baskets filled with a spongy yellow substance into a hopper. Two adults turn a spoked wheel, and out of a thin tube at the far end, a yellow powder is produced. Let's ask the child about the basket. I don't know if I should be touching and taking stuff just yet. What is in the basket? You ask one of the rascals near the back. The girl shrugs. Whatever it's called. I call it stink because of the stink. What's it for? You ask. It's for putting into the machine, the girl replies stubbornly. And then I get some more. The girl unloads her yellow stink and then vanishes. A moment later, she is back at the back of the line with a full basket. The boy reappears at your side. Please, he says, indicating the door. You're distracting the workers. He moves you toward the door. Now we're leaving? Something more is at work here. We didn't just go back in time. These people are disappearing and reappearing. It's like they're ghosts in the past as well. But how do they work so quickly? You ask. The boy gleams, or beams, actually, with obvious delight. You are pleased with our progress. I am glad. We will deliver the quantities required soon, please. The boy opens the door and holds it ajar. That's right, he thinks I'm the overseer. Well, that's pretty bossy, right? I'm not done overseeing, damn it. Give me some of the powder. You declare. Of course. The boy nods, vanishes, and reappears instantly with a small vial of yellow dust, which he hands to you. Then he indicates the door and you step through. You've seen enough. The ghosts are teleporters. How odd. Let's look at our items, eh? Stone dust, we already have that. Oh, the yellow powder. So we still have the stone dust. I'm glad for that. So we try to turn someone else to stone. 3 Firefox fangs, 3 Snatticat's teeth. Okay. That is very loud. You step back out onto the street. Look back. Looking back, you notice for the first time the roof of the warehouse sloping but with several wooden beams that lean outwards like open arms lifting to the sky. You gasp. The whole building appears to be a grimalkin, like those you saw as an apprentice. Magical constructions which gather magic the way a funnel gathers rainwater. Surely not. No one could construct a grimalkin on such a scale. It seems impossible. Lost in thought, you wander the streets. I guess we're going to the high city. Let me just check out... We still have this food, right? Raw meat. I guess maybe it'll come the next time we rest or sleep or something. Because I have raw meat. I have Firefox fangs, which can be used to cook something, etc., or set something on fire. I also have a tinderbox. I think I have all the elements required here. Let's go to the high city. You follow the winding, climbing, stepped streets into the upper reaches of the city. Low hovels and clustered buildings are replaced by larger buildings, mansions, palaces, and central offices. You pass a familiar building daubed in red paint with two doors. Obviously, I'm looking at the building. Above one door is a sign with a picture of a fanged tooth. Above the other is a metal implement that looks like a small pair of tongs. Fanged tooth, well, could be either weapons or food. And tongs, I'm thinking a smelter or a smithy. Let's open the tooth door. I'm hoping they sell some food. You open the door to find it leads into a wide hall, which the other door also opens onto, or into. In a large chair at one end sits a man with a tight-fitting leather cap. On a low table at his elbow rests an array of metal implements. He stands as you enter. Does he have one of the telepathy caps on? Inside the hall. Greetings, declares the merchant. Are you here to buy or to sell? A strange question, since there appears to be nothing on sale, unless the goods are all behind a curtain that covers the back wall. What is your trade, good sir? You ask, puzzled. He seems surprised. You didn't see the sign? You're a blacksmith, you're a dentist, you're a supplier of magical artifacts. Oh, I see nothing on sale. I'm thinking the tongs is the blacksmith. Maybe. Dentist seems funny. You're a supplier of magical artifacts? Well, this is Tinpang, home to the miners of minor magic. That's clever. He laughs, then falls quiet, seeing your lack of comprehension. But I take it then you are not simply in the market for teeth? Teeth? Indeed. Teeth of all kinds. What kinds do you sell? I have a few rarities in my possession today. A genuine Firefox tooth, two Snatticat teeth, and my prized possession, the tooth of a rock demon. Huh. Well, we already have three, I believe, Firefox teeth and two... I think we have three... I'm curious now. I think we have three of each, right? Yeah, three Firefox... How many... teeth do we need, but the one we don't have is a rock demon. How much for the rock demon? Ah, he replies with a gleam. You're a woman of taste, I see. Zquix, whatever. He snaps his fingers and a stooped figure appears from the back carrying an enormous crystal rock. It is clearly extremely heavy. In perfect condition, as you see, the man replies. Virtually flawless. Yours for a mere 32 gold pieces. I want to examine it. Actually, it is too much. You look it over. The tooth shape is indistinct. Ridges and whorls in a crystal cube, but the sense of magic surrounding it is palpable. That is too much. Too much is the price my servant paid in getting it, the merchant replies. You will have to believe me on that, as the poor woman is no longer here to demonstrate her injuries. You politely decline. It is still too much for me. Just out of curiosity, how much for the Firefox teeth? You can take it from me, the merchant replies. Just 5 gold pieces. What good is a Firefox tooth? You ask. The merchant smiles. A curious beast, the Firefox. Yeah, I met one, yeah, personally. It contains the elemental nature of fire within itself. The teeth can be broken to ignite a small flame. He demonstrates breaking an imaginary fang with imaginary fang between his hands. Are you interested? Well, I have three, so don't buy it. You shake your head. I have a tinderbox already. The merchant nods. As you will. I also have teeth. How much for the Snatticat? Just curious. Snatticat teeth are very valuable, he replies. 10 gold pieces each. No. This I'm actually wondering what it could be used for, but I'm not going to buy it, obviously. You decide against it. You're clearly no great magician, he agrees. You close your pack and your money pouch. He shrugs, clearly having marked you for not a big spender. It's, not that. It's just I have three of each. Maybe I can sell one or two of them? I don't know what the Snatticat teeth are for, but they're more valuable. I have something perhaps to sell. Excellent, he leans forward keenly. Your own teeth? Oh, those of others. Huh, what? You would buy my teeth? Indeed I would. The man peers closely at you and then nods. One of your molars, perhaps? A molar from good stock is always a precious commodity. What use is a molar? You ask, intrigued. Ah, my apologies. I took you for a sorcerer. Teeth are a valuable, indeed indispensable, component of what we call summoning spells. So, a giant's tooth may summon a giant, and a Snatticat tooth may summon a Snatticat. A human molar in good condition can be used to summon a subservient human, which I'm sure you can imagine has tremendous uses. Huh. Then why does a Firefox tooth summon flame and not a Firefox? What is the spell for summoning a human? You demand. This is no magic you have heard of previously. If your master is in, teach it to you. The merchant replies cautiously. Then I think it's best that you don't know. Besides, I merely sell the teeth. How much for a molar? For one of yours, well... he sighs a happy smile. I would say 30 gold pieces at least. You're strong and intelligent. I can see that much from the curve of your incisors. Would that seem fair to you? Okay. Well, this is a quandary I'm glad to have you guys vote on for me, because I'm kind of torn. 30 gold pieces. I may be rich, but hopefully we'll have something to buy with it. There's not really been a lot of stuff to buy in this section of the adventure. But yeah, if he's on a level, we just lose one molar, right? Still be able to eat, I'm assuming. And my apologies, my voice is cracking. So we would have 43 gold pieces. Boom! We've never had anyone anywhere near. I think I had 30 or 32 or something at one point. 43 gold pieces. I could also try to upsell him. That might anger him. That might just close off the deal. Or I might actually get more out of him. Don't know. Or, yeah, so I could sell my tooth, try to upscale, or say my teeth are not for sale and screw it. Because, I mean, technically, this is slavery. But then again, it's no better or worse than when we summon a giant, right? I at the beginning of this episode, I decided not to kill a giant, right? But I have effectively enslaved a giant in the past, and a goblin or two. Yeah, right? Is that, should I be enabling that? Now, I'm just selling a tooth. I'm not doing the enslaving. He actually just sells a teeth, so he's not even doing the enslaving either. But we're both enabling it to, we're both allowing it to, you know, to continue and stuff. So, I don't think I'd lose favor with Kurga for doing so. Kurga? I don't know. So, let me know what you guys think in the comments below. This is a very interesting moral decision, isn't it? I mean, you could take it that way. You could say, hey, you know, I need to survive, and I need to get the crown of kings, you know, to stop the Archmage and bring peace to the land and all this stuff, so... Could be, you know, seen as a means to an end. Or a temporary thing. So let me know what you guys think. Stop babbling now. Yeah. Sell the tooth. Say screw you, I'm not sell the tooth. Keep on as we are. Keep our teeth. Keep our 13 gold. Or should I try to upsell him? So yeah, thanks guys for voting. Really appreciate it. And yeah, that's about it. Endure. In enduring, grow strong. See you next week.